didn't happen not for a reason, because in the past, when the stress response, it could be when there's the animal running after us as a caveman or cavewoman, then we need these responses to either fight or flight with the animal. But now in modern society, our stress situation isn't happening this way anymore. Yeah. And then when the animal comes and goes, it's a very short episode. But when it's there for a very long period of time, then it starts to have an effect on our health. Yeah. And immune system slow down as well. That happens because actually when there's release of a lot of stress hormones, those hormones actually need to pick up a lot of our nutrients that we have in our body. So that affects our body system as well. And to the extreme of this is there's even such a thing called the broken heart syndrome, where the stress can actually cause the heart to mimic a heart attack. Yeah. So it's actually brought on by a stressful situation. Maybe, for example, the loved one suddenly got into a car accident and was very seriously injured. Yeah. So that brought on these kind of symptoms as well. So the stress hormone actually stunned the heart. Cause it to temporarily enlarge and it doesn't pump well anymore. Yeah, so there is a direct association between all this stress and heart health as well, which is why we say it's important to be able to monitor it well.
This is prolonged, not sudden.
This is a sudden one. So, I mean, the good thing is usually if they get sent quickly for intervention, the recovery rate is usually quite okay. Yeah. This shows us that actually stress can really affect our heart to such an extent as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No, I just my mind is wondering, because there's something you watch drama. The old man grabs his heart or his chest and says, oh, because the son was, well, did something wrong. So it's also drama, but it's actually real.
Yeah, and then it actually affects women mostly.
Yeah. You're more emotional.
Yeah. Yeah. Strong. I would cry, you know, when that one, I would cry.
Mix it.
Yeah. So just now we've been talking about women, right? So when we think about women, do we think about such images? Or do you think of yourself this way? How many the first one?
First one better.
So, but when you think about women, then do you think of the first one?
No, think of first one, then you will stress the job. Think of this one, and then yourself will work worse. Yeah, you must think of, like, even they say that you want to go diet and when you see a slimming baby, then what? But you can see your fat one, wow, worse thing, like, reverse effect.
So that helps you to relax.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think
when you come to the soul.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah. But in reality, we are usually juggling with a lot of things. So a lot of us, for women especially, we have a lot of different roles. So these are just some of the few roles that we have. Like be a wife, mother, housewife, etc., worker. Yeah. So there is a lot of research or things talking about how women and the roles actually do affect the stress level and how women always wants to take care of others before herself. And that plays an impact on their health as well. So before we carry on, we have this in our booklet. Yeah, so we are just going to use this to help us think a little bit of our role. Yeah. So for example, the first one. So it can be, I used to do this, I'm not doing this now, I would like to do this in the future. Then next is how important it is to you, not important, quite important, very important. And if this role is something that you are doing now, then you can go on to rate the level of stress when performing, for example, the worker role. So one is not stressful, 10 is very stressful. Yeah. And then next is the level of satisfaction in performing this role. So same thing, one is not satisfied, 10 is very satisfied. Spend some time to do this first.
Sorry, when you talk about worker, you're talking about salary worker, right? you're retired, you have no outlook.
Mm. How's life not doing anything?
How's life then? There's another, there's a role.
You don't do anything.
That's like a work you don't do at all.
Yeah, that's why they manage the house.
Outside we can put under looking after my home.
How important, if I say used to, when I was doing it, how important?
If you are not doing that role now, you don't have to raise the stress level and satisfaction.
Yeah, because there's so many things you're doing on the TV. the whole dinner for you. What's the best story you had? Then in the end, you want it.
This will be how it is.
Yeah, that's why I think I
like it.
I
like
it. I like it. I like it. I like it. I like it. I like it.
Or whether you ace it or not, it's not the main part of life. The main part of life is to enjoy life and to just live, you know, happily. There's no need to achieve a lot of things and then you ace in education and then climb up the corporate ladder and then yet you are like a rat in a race. Mm. You know, not enjoying life at all. Life is not all about studies, it's not all about certain things that you can see.
Recently, there was a study when they asked young kids like what is most important in life. Then many, or even parents, they asked then what do you think is most important to see in our children? Then they say health and happiness.
Yes.
Yeah. So then they asked, but what is our education system teaching in school? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So they say that there's a conflict.
Opinions have changed. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Last time, parents stressed a lot on education.
generation, but now they experience themselves. Mm. After all this, so what's next? Mm. Mm.
So that's now, thank you for sharing. Yeah. So we acknowledge that we have, as women, we are an important part in our society because we have many different roles and networks. So while we satisfying, we also do experience some stress. And actually, no matter whether it's good changes or bad changes, as long as there's changes, actually it's stressful. So sometimes when I think, hey, I have a new grandson, then we're getting a new house, I'm going to travel soon, they are all good things, but am I still feeling so stressed? Yeah, but as long as it's changes to us, then it can also create stress. Yeah, so as much as possible, we should try to pace it out. Yeah, so that we don't feel so challenged all the time.
But the joy overrides the stress, because like say, talking about grandson. Mm. You expect a new grandson and you look forward to, wow, having a baby around the house. Mm. Does that joy override the stress? Like, yeah, you should worry, will the child not help you, with the, you know, everything else. Mm. Would that override it? I mean, sort of.
That we are going to talk a bit later.
Okay.
Yeah. So just to reinforce again that for women taking care of others come naturally. Yeah, but we need to help ourselves stay in the pink of health so that can be there for those who love. So it's important to know what are the symptoms of stress, because a lot of times we talk about stress but we might not know how it actually is displayed in our own. Yeah. So just now you mentioned that all of us have different sort of symptoms. So as we go through, maybe you can also start thinking, hey, do I have these stress symptoms? So firstly is the pain of having too much stress, the physical symptoms. So it can manifest itself as having migraine or tension headache. So a lot of times when we feel more stressed, then we like tense up our muscle. So that's when all the neck and shoulder aches might happen. Yeah. So just now, Anders was also talking about rapid heart rate. Right? Yeah. And then appetite might be affected. Some people eat more when they feel stressed. Yeah. Yeah, they feel comfort food, eat chocolate, eat ice cream, yeah, feels better.
Sounds like a vomit.
Yeah, some feel like no mood, I don't want to eat. So some people can get their indigestion or constipation. Yeah. Then there might be increased sensitivity to light and sound. Maybe you used to like to have all your grandchildren running around you, but when you feel very stressed, then you feel very conflicted by that. Yeah. So then you might feel the nausea or dizziness. Yeah. Sleep gets affected as well. Yeah. So you can see that for quite a few, they can be either or kind of thing. Yeah. So it varies from and then other than physical, that's the mental symptoms of too much stress as well. So you can get more anxious or your mood might be more low, get angry easier, which just how a few of you said, might have some start to appear some nervous habits. Getting forgetful is something that appears in myself quite a fair bit. Yeah, so I get stressed and I tend to forget what I want to do next, and then even though I'm proceeding to that phase.
I thought the voice for me.
They always forget things.
I can't remember.
Yeah, sometimes you go down to the shop.
Or talk about you. Stop the kitchen if you know you're there.
Yeah. It depends. I mean, we usually have a baseline, but you find that you start to be quite different from your baseline forgetfulness. Yeah, that is the sound symptoms. Yeah.
That is the aging process. That everybody go through, is it? Yeah. I don't know.
I mean, there is some part due to aging process, yeah. But it's also there's a line between how much is too much and then how much is like
natural. How much is too
So sometimes when we get more angry, etc., the relationship might get affected as well. So there's strained communication. So why is it important to know this stress level? Because actually stress and productivity is related. So when we have totally no stress at all, actually we are not productive. So maybe when we have no job, no family anymore, we feel that maybe no stress really, but then you might be lying in bed all day, no motivation to want to do anything anymore. Yeah. So actually some amount of stress is actually good for us. Yeah. So we each have an optimal level of stress. Yeah. So but I cannot say at about 45 points is the best for you. Because it differs from different person to person. Yeah. So how knowing the symptoms will help is that when you start to, maybe my beginning symptom is I will start to activate. Means I will start to be more forgetful. Yeah, then I will be able to monitor myself. This means that maybe something to get a bit out of the optimal level, I might need to do something to actually help me to relieve my stress a little bit. Yeah. Because if it goes on, then you will experience burnout and it might prolong the effect on our health, like what are some of the symptoms, earlier heart symptoms that you mentioned just now. And then just now, to your question, yeah, so stress is actually useful, but too much stress plus the inability to cope with stress, then it becomes a dysfunction. Yeah, so it depends. So it could be the person's perception or whether there's other things to cope with the demands of stress. Yeah, so that actually affects how much they synthesize and whether it's a motivation or a dysfunction. So now we are going to explore a little bit about how do you manage your stress. So in this thing,
chop the husband.
I didn't hear that. Yeah. Yeah, this form. So these are some of the common things, but if there are others, you can write it down below as well.
Shopping no money also stress.
No, no money but don't have your size also
stress. A lot of things to stress about.
You choose your stress.
Yeah, that's right.
Thank you.
mean, you bring me the
that's
that.
Why you today never clean your face? Talk it out. Yelling is not advisable. Mm.
It's a natural reaction.
It's supposed to be not advisable. Supposed
you
to
don't choose it at all.
From parent, from a family point of view, this word should not be applicable. Because you create you a positive, the negative impact of the life. You take more of the negative side rather than the positive side.
But this is a general list that people sometimes use. So I think all of you have finished ticking the different checklists. So it's a very long list, so I won't ask you all to share, but basically it's a list for you all to just rethink about the how we have been managing sometimes with stress and see whether maybe we have some coping strategy that's positive, but are we doing it often enough sometimes? Yeah. If we say travel is something I use to manage my stress, but maybe I travel maybe once every 2 years, then maybe that is not sufficient enough. Yeah. Or if there's only just one or two strategies, then maybe we can explore other types to complement ourselves. Like they say, don't put all your eggs in one basket. Yeah. So it's good to have many different ones in case one feels there's another as well. So today we are going to just introduce relaxation. Yeah. So this relaxation is not some magic potion, but what happens is that while there's a stress response in our body, there is also a relaxation response in our body that we can elicit. Yeah. So how do we elicit this relaxation response is two main key things. One is the focus of a repetition of a word or a phrase or activity. So common things that y'all might have heard of is maybe things like meditation, focusing on maybe yoga, etc. Yeah. So and then the second part, which is a bit more difficult, is when there is everyday thoughts, learning how to register it but not pay attention to it and bringing the focus back to what you are doing now. But sometimes like, maybe we try to relax and then start to think about, yeah, later what I want to cook for dinner. Then you start to think, oh, I haven't get my garlic, I haven't get my onions, and then you start going into it, then you will lose the focus on relaxation. But you might, if you want to practice this, then I say, on what I will cook for dinner, then might register, okay, I'm having a thought in my mind, let's return my focus to the deep breathing. Yeah, and then you will be able to manage the relaxation response. So how it helps is that every day we might have some things that cause us to have a little bit increase of stress. So it's something that we practice to bring the stress level down a little bit so that it's always at a manageable level. So if the stress is escalating up and we don't do anything to manage stress, then it goes to a level just not like we say, then all the different symptoms start to appear. Yeah. So it's a bit like exercise that Kemi is going to talk about later. You don't wait until you have a very serious health condition then you want to start exercising, right? You know, relaxation is the same thing. You don't wait until you have a very serious, maybe mental breakdown then you want to do something about it. Yeah, so it's something about maintaining the positive well-being in general. So how are we going to do it? So now I need all of you to maybe put both your feet on the floor. Yeah, then lean back on your chair, make yourself comfortable. So demo first, then later we will practice together. Yeah. So with one hand on the chest and one hand on the stomach.
Whichever hand.
Whichever hand, yeah. So when I breathe out, my stomach actually inflates, goes up. And then when I breathe out through the mouth, the stomach actually goes in. Yeah. So when you breathe in, stomach out. When you breathe out, stomach in. Yeah. You can lean back and relax on your chair. Then we will practice for a while. You can close your eyes, then we will practice and go around.
Thank you.
Just I'm comfortable for me because I could feel my ear go happy. So I was trying to match the beat and I found myself shocked. So I was like, I breathed up halfway and then I stopped, then I forgot to breathe. I said, I really forgot. I didn't. Oh, okay. I was, you know, I was holding my breath.
Okay. Yeah, maybe for you, maybe both hands on the stomach, like, it would better. With the hand on the heart, then you start to feel the heart rate.
No, I actually can sense my heart. Because my heart, if I did it, it's quite interesting.
Okay. Yeah. So it's still the practice of focusing just on the breathing.
So it means remove the thought of my heart. But I can't because it's just there, like, hey, you know.
Yeah. But you see, there's a lot of different sensations in our body going on at one go. So it's also focusing our attention on which aspect as well. So
when it comes, I find it pretty weird. So that's okay.
So just some of you mentioned that it's actually not how we usually do, because usually when we breathe in, there's stomach.
I was breathing with my stomach.
So this is the technique to elicit the relaxation response. So in sitting, it might be a bit more difficult. So if you want to practice, the lying down might be the easiest position to practice it. So it's like learning how to cycle. When you first cycle, you wobble on the bicycle. Then if let's say something comes chasing after you, you probably fall off on the bicycle. But if you practice it long enough and you can cycle well, when something comes, you can do it as a second nature. So it's same thing, it's a new skill. So if you are keen to explore whether it can help you to make yourself feel, maintain your well-being, then we have to practice for a duration of time before we can see whether there's any effect from it as well. Okay, so coming to the end, what are some of the few steps is understanding what the situation that causes stress and knowing your own symptoms so that you can monitor it well, and then decide and choose some of the strategies to manage your stress, and lastly, investing time in yourself and practice the strategies identified. So there's no use if you know we have 101 strategies, but then you don't spend any time doing that as well. So for just now, like we say, if you are keen to explore whether it can help, maybe good to practice the deep breathing. And we have something to help you to monitor if you are keen to use it. So this is calendar. So after you practice, you can actually tick in the date. So for example, today is the 5th, then you can tick it there. And if you want, you want to go a further step, you can even say it's how you feel after that. Yeah. So that's something to help you monitor. Yeah. Sometimes we don't have something a lot. This one look like homework, lah, but sometimes it does help. Because sometimes when you don't have a lot, then when people ask, so how often do you try to practice? Then also very hard to remember. Then like I say, sometimes turn forgetful, then might not remember. Then. Yeah. So if this is something you want to invest in yourself, then you can potentially use this to help. Yeah. And if you want to better monitor your stress, the last page has a table that you can write down like what are the stressful situations, what are the symptoms that happen, and how do you try to manage it. Yeah. So that the next time around when we have the individual sessions, you can bring it here and we can discuss further about them as well. Yeah.
How long do you recommend to do this breathing exercise just every day?
How long?
Like 10 minutes, 2 hours.
2 hours. I mean, if you do it before you sleep, then you can actually practice it until you fall asleep. Yeah. If not, actually 5 to 10 minutes is good as well. Yeah. There's no hard and fast rule.
Okay, you can lie down and do it also.
Yeah, you can lie down. Usually,
Usually
it's easier to start with lying. Yeah, after you manage to master in lying, then you realize you can start doing it in sitting, standing even. Yeah. I tried before. Sometimes when you feel that you need to
de-stress
afterwards. Yeah, correct. Unload yourself on the work. Then I can do it anywhere now, so I can just focus on doing it. Then it just helps. After that.
So at your level now, you don't even have to put your hands, right? You can just breathe.
Yeah.
Okay. Feel free.
So in next month is individual, and then the following month will be another group session again. So in the next group session, we'll be talking about more about these strategies and other relaxation techniques. Yeah, that's all. Any burning questions? Okay.
Are you, does a person, what is this, be stressed by certain things and not, so that you ding dong between being stressed and not stressed through the day? So like, example, if I see A or a person or do a certain thing, I get very upset, I get agitated before I even begin, like, I'm going to be this person, I'm so terrible, it's kind of thing. And then so you get stressed. And then the next moment, because I'm playing my son, I'm with my son having lunch, it's so relaxing.
It's possible.
It's
so,
possible.
Yeah, so just now the stress situation, like you said, is because of the cognitive thoughts that we have in our mind.
That past experience kind of thing.
So then, but the part we're playing with our grandson, it could be the could be the coping strategy or the time out time that you have. Actually enjoy and be in the flow of enjoying that moment, that helps then your stress level to come down a little bit.
Okay, the reason why I asked is because at the beginning I perceive that stress is continuous. If once you let yourself into a stressful situation like kids' exams, then it's continuous, like it's non-stop, like every day you wake up, you go, you got science, you got next tuition, and then you worry all the time too. But I find that sometimes for myself it's like certain things really set off, I'm going to be ABC, this guy is so irritating, kind of thing. Then, oh wait, I'm having tea, so that's nice. You know, that kind of thing. So I was wondering whether it's come as it comes or it's a throughout thing.
Yeah, so it's like what we say in this graph here. Yeah. So there will be some things that increase the stress, but if we do have some events or practice that we can do, that we enjoy, then it can help the stress level to come down. So we can maintain it at a healthy level. Yeah. So what happens if we have something that trigger us off, very stressed, but we don't do anything about it? Then let's say somewhere here another incident happened, then that could trigger us off even.
So like if I see this person today and he stresses me up to level 2, then I don't see him for 2 months, and then when I see him again, the next time I see him again, I get stressed again.
Yeah.
So it can actually build on in the interim gap.
Yeah. If you can. Sometimes you can't control.
Yeah, it's true, it's true. Okay, so as Deja mentioned earlier, actually one of your coping strategies for stress is actually through exercise. But of course, I'm sure everyone here in the room will know the benefits of exercise, isn't it? The question is whether we are doing them or whether we're doing enough or how to bring ourselves to actually do them continuously or frequently enough. Yeah. Okay, so today's content will go through firstly just very briefly about the benefits of exercise, and later I'll talk about the exercise guidelines, and followed by the safety of exercise, and last but not least, how to monitor yourself when you are exercising by yourself. Okay. So benefits of exercise. Can anyone tell me just briefly on top of their head, what are the benefits of exercise you can think of?
Slim
down. Okay, weight management. Okay, anything else?
Good for your body and then your heart.
Good for the body and the heart. So you're saying?
Lower cholesterol.
Lower cholesterol, yes, yes. And anything else?
Because I exercise.
Okay. So I'm sure for a lot of people they will know, I mean, weight management, good for the heart and the lungs, lower cholesterol. These are all the very obvious benefits of exercise. Okay, but of course there are many more other benefits of exercise. Okay, so let's look through them now in a bit more detail. So actually if you do exercise, also depending on what type of exercise that you do, because actually there are various types of exercise. If you do strength training, of course that will help to build out your muscle strength. And actually you are never too old to actually build out your muscle strength. Actually, I have patients that they come to me and say, oh, are you sure that my muscles can still work? But actually, you'll be surprised, you know, like actually, regardless of age, as long as you exercise your muscles, you can actually bring your muscles to its more optimal strength, okay? Now, the other one is flexibility. Later on, I'll also talk about that in a bit more details, because our stretching exercise is actually very important to maintain our joint mobility, and also it helps us to minimize any soft tissues injury as well. And also actually I would say 80% of the ladies I see who often complain of aches and pains in their body is also because they don't do any stretching as well. So that is part of the benefits of doing stretching exercise. And of course, don't forget that when we exercise, when our body is fitter, that actually helps to improve our immunity, and also improve our balance, and helps to build out our bones and prevent falls. Okay. So here just a picture of a normal bone density. We all know the condition of osteoporosis. So we know that actually when we exercise, we actually load our bone density. Well, of course, I'm sure a lot of people here will understand, probably some of you are taking calcium supplement, yeah? Because we all know that when women hit menopause, one of the side effects or the one of the effects of menopause is losing out the calcium. Okay? But of course, part of our body retaining calcium is actually through exercise. Okay? So no point just taking your calcium tablets, you also must exercise to help to actually obtain that. Okay? And of course, other exercises are benefits to the elderly is improve the fitness, weight management, as some of us already talked about. And social interaction. You'd be surprised that a lot of people, I mean, maybe when they cook up at home, they feel very down, depressed, you know, they can't stand the people in their house. But when they're outside with their friends, even just walking, they feel much better. You know, it's part of the social interaction as well as the feeling of you doing something for your body that makes you make yourself feel happier. And stress reduction, as we said already, and better sleep. You know, a lot of people who suffer from insomnia, part of the reason is why they do have that is also because they actually don't go out and actually, use their energy to do something, so that don't tie themselves down enough. But so for a lot of people who actually do a lot of exercise, and by the end of the day, they feel so tired, and often they'll get a much better sleep.
And not, don't forget also it helps with our bowel movement as well. Yeah. So the things that we also know about the benefit of exercise is helps to help us to monitor our lower our blood pressure or control our blood pressure, and also maintain our good cholesterol in the body. And actually also if you're diabetic, it helps to control your sugar level as well. So one of the management for diabetic people is also to do regular exercises. And also when your body is fitter, you'll feel that less fatigue, you have more energy to do your daily tasks. And also it helps to prevent heart disease. And of course when we say prevent strokes, it's also part of it come live together with blood pressure control as well. So there are so many benefits. So we know that there's the exercise helps to improve our cardiovascular fitness and also helps to improve our psychological well-being, and overall then it helps to improve the quality of life. Okay, so after we're talking about all these good things about exercise, how many people here actually do regular exercises? One hand, some people smiling, don't know yes or no.
Walking, we are not. I try to walk.
Okay, walking, yes.
Sometimes once a week, because from bus stop to house and things.
Right, yes.
Then I pass on how about 1 kilometer.
Oh, okay.
Then I do and fro.
Yes, yes.
Then I do night exercise before or after.
Stretching. Yes. Okay. But of course, later on, I'll talk about in actually more details. Actually, also, whether you exercise enough also depends on what you want to achieve as well. If people say, I want to achieve weight loss, then of course you'll be looking at doing more cardiovascular workout. Mm-hmm. If you say, I just want to improve my flexibility, then of course stretching is probably enough. Okay, and some other people say, I want to feel stronger, build up my muscle strength, then actually you need to do strength training. So it's slightly different again. So I'll actually talk all about that in the later details as well, later part of the talk. So how to select appropriate exercise? That is the question. Okay, so again, depending on what you want to do. But I'm sure most of us here will want to firstly want to improve our heart and lungs. That would be the most important thing, isn't it? So let's look at the exercise guidelines then. Okay, before we actually look at the exercise guidelines, then we must understand what we are doing, okay, and the principles of exercise. Okay, so basically there are four things that need to think about exercising. The frequency, that is how many times per week. So I heard one of your, so you mentioned about once or twice per week, right? Okay, so that would be you, okay. That probably would be not quite enough to get the cardiovascular workout, but later I'll explain to you what you can do to actually increase the frequency. So that would be frequency. And secondly is the intensity. So how hard is the exercise? Okay, so a lot of people, they feel that it's very difficult to tell, is this exercise too difficult for me or not? Because they feel, oh, running is okay, every day I run, so it feels quite easy to me. So of course, various intensity may to certain different people, is actually, it differs, whether is it too intensive or not, it really depends on each individual. So whether you feel this exercise is too difficult for yourself or not, you really need to look at your body response as well. And later on, I'll talk about that as well. And the duration as well, so time, how much time do you spend to exercise per week, and the type. So these are the four things that we need to consider when we are exercising. So the first type of exercise I already mentioned is actually stretching. So stretching is very important to help to maintain or improve our joint mobility, improve our posture, and it also helps to alleviate the muscle aches and pains that we often get after exercise. So that's why it's very important to do stretching exercise after you've done your, say, your daily walk or your weekly walk, okay? Now, strength training, that's the exercise that helps to improve our muscle strength. Now, a lot of people may think that, oh, strength training, that's only for those guys that want to build up their big muscles. But actually, you'll be surprised, for females, it's also important to do some sort of strength training. Because when your muscle is actually fitter, stronger, they actually their metabolism is faster. So in a way, it also helps to burn out calories as well. So having stronger muscles actually also help you to control your weight in some extent. Okay, so the other type of exercise is the balance exercise, which also helps to prevent falls.
So can anyone think of what type of exercise consider a balanced exercise? Yoga, yes, some people mentioned that. Anything else?
Cycling?
Okay, cycling depends on, if you do stationary bikes, it's probably not considered a balanced exercise such. But of course, if you do actual real biking, yes, of course, that probably requires some sort of balance.
Line dancing,
yeah. Okay, actually, dancing, you could also say that it's a form of balancing because it does, you there's some time that you spend maybe only one foot on the ground and the other. So that also requires some sort of balance. So actually, very simple balance is like yoga, tai chi. Tai chi is also a form of balance. But of course, a more simpler form of exercise, balance exercise, is just standing on one leg, for example. Yeah. And for some people who has frequent falls, even walking by itself is also can consider a balance exercise by itself. But of course, for most of the majority of people here who don't really have falls risk, now, of course, a higher level of balance exercise is probably more appropriate, such as dancing, yoga, tai chi, etc. Okay? So, as you can see, we have a picture of people sitting on a gym ball or even people standing on a foam. Okay? So, there are various things that you can actually challenge your balance. Okay? So, last but not least, the cardiovascular workout. So this is the type that helps to improve our heart and lungs, and of course that is the one that most of us are more interested in, yeah? So the type of cardiovascular, think of what types? Jogging, swimming, dancing, yes? Walking? Actually, any sort of continuous workout that helps to maintain your heart level at a slightly faster pace, and then you maintain over an extended period of time, is considered cardiovascular. So even cycling also can be considered cardiovascular. Yeah. Okay?
Even weightlifting?
Okay, not weightlifting, because you will not be doing, actually correct weightlifting you should not be doing for too long.
Right.
So if say you do weightlifting for over 20 minutes non-stop, okay, that probably will become a cardiovascular workout.
Okay, sorry, not with circuit training.
Oh, circuit training.
Yeah.
Okay, provided that you, so yeah, that can be considered as part of cardiovascular because even though you change stations, but of course, yeah, you kept going so that your heart rate is still maintained at a slightly faster level than your resting level. So that is considered cardiovascular, yes. So aerobic, all the high, low, intense aerobic, that is all cardiovascular. Yeah. So, okay, so how to monitor the intensity then after we know about different type of exercises? So a very simple one that you can do for your to monitor yourself is the walk and talk test. So light intensity workout is those type that you can consider to do it very easily. You can even sing, you know, like it doesn't really bother you at all. You know, you don't even feel like you're doing it. Okay, that is probably light exercise. Moderate exercise, those type that, okay, you can feel that you're doing some workout, but you can still speak in full sentences. That is considered moderate. And rigorous workout are type that you cannot talk in full sentence. You'll be huffing. Okay, that is rigorous, okay? So like I say, different intensity, maybe to different people, they differ slightly. So for the more fitter type of people, maybe certain rigorous exercises, they do not feel very, doesn't feel very hard as to compare to somebody maybe more sedentary. Okay. So then again you must monitor yourself and know your body as well. Okay. So there are so many questions I'm sure some of you already have in your mind. So how long do I need to exercise to get a good workout? What intensity should I be exercising and what type of exercise is the best and how many times a week? Okay. Now can anyone guess, maybe take a guess. What do you think would be considered the ideal type if you want to talk about cardiovascular?
1 week, 2 times a week.
3 and then?
And then 1 hour a day or 45 to 1 hour.
So we're looking at 45 to 60 minutes duration, 3 times a day. Yep. Moderate or hard?
Moderate.
I guess some people heart rate go faster. I see you cannot talk in full sentence faster than. Some will be able to just keep on talking and go on doing.
Yes, I mean, you're right too, yeah. So it really depends on the individual. Of course, if you know your yourself that okay, I'm not a very fit type. Then of course you start off with a more moderate one. And but it's to compare, say, some people who are already very used to exercising very regularly, and therefore of course for them, if you want to push themselves a little bit harder, they can go up to a fit type, slightly more vigorous type. Yeah, so you're right. But then again, those people, actually one of the things that we do teach people about monitoring themselves is actually measure their own heart, their pulse as well. Because by right, depending if your heart is working normally, okay, about 2 minutes after you stop exercising, your heart rate should slowly go back to your normal heart rate already. So if it takes longer than that for you to go back, that means you probably have pushed yourself too hard as well. Okay, so that is if you want to get into really quick details about that, you know, like some people they have a heart monitor, you know, these days people you see them wearing it, you know, like looking at what, you know, there. But if you're not really interested to be so detailed about it, okay, you can just use your how hard you're breathing as a guide as well. Okay, so actually the health promotion board recommends that if you talk about strength training now, okay, you should actually do about 2 to 3 times a week. You don't need to do it every day. In fact, if you do it every day, that's wrong. Okay? Okay, but before I go into cardiovascular, but the type of strength training, can anyone think of the type of strength training day that you can think of that maybe you can do?
Carry weights.
Jogging. Okay, jogging may be slightly considered more like cardiovascular. Yeah.
Resistance training.
Yes. So strength training will be more like a resistance training, whereby you load your arm muscles and leg muscles. So if you say at home you have a can of say some sort of soup can, for example, if you want to hold it in your hand and you can, you know, raise it up or do the make your elbow. Okay, that is a form of strength training. Okay, and for the legs, actually like squats. Okay, if you do it slowly, that is considered a strength training as well. Or even go up and down one step. Okay, that is also considered strength training for the legs. Okay, but again, I must stress the importance that when you do strength training, no need to go up to like 50, 60 reps, okay? That is again wrong. Imagine you might injure your muscles by doing that. Okay, you only need about 9 to 12 reps. That's all, okay? And then you only do about 2 to 3 times a day. But of course, the true strength training is that the weights that you do, you use by the end of the 9 to 12 reps, by the end of that, you should feel that, oh, I don't think I can carry on anymore. But of course, for most of the ladies here, as a start off, I probably don't recommend you carry such a heavy weight immediately. So maybe you just get a hold of a light weight and do about 12 repetitions would be fine.
Without weights?
Sorry?
Just
if you want to do without weights, is it? You can do too if you like, but of course if you have a slight weight, it will be a little bit more effective. But then again, because if you say, I never done this before, I don't know whether my joints can take it or not, then maybe you start out without any weights, it's also fine. Yeah, and then you can slowly increase the weights as to what you feel that whether you can manage or not.
I'm waiting for the bus. So instead of doing nothing, or then you learn that. Sometimes you don't know, like, just do a little bit, then you increase your, that's what we used to type,
circulation for the fingers.
Yeah, just the keyboard, so instead of just a few times and things, I think you just, I don't know, you need it, at least help a little bit, lah.
Yeah, I mean, of course, sure, I mean, anything, as long as you're moving your joints, better than if you don't move anything.
Don't move at all.
Yeah, that's fine, yeah. Okay, and then the cardiovascular, that's the one we're talking about. Okay, we have some guesses about 45 to 60 minutes. Actually, all you need is 30 minutes. but you must do minimum 5 times per week, okay? But of course, this is just a guide, okay? If you want to be, to start off with, we actually say 30 minutes duration, but you can actually break it down into 10 minutes interval each time. Because I know for a lot of working people, they really don't have the time to actually squeeze in 30 minutes to do their workout. So if you can split it out to about 10 minutes, even morning, afternoon, and nighttime, they still be fine. So as long as it's continuously about 10 minutes or more, okay? And one day you accumulate up to 30 minutes, and then that is actually considered cardiovascular. Here we say minimum 5 times, but actually, if you, in fact, if you can do it 7 days, it will be even better. Of course, the more the merrier. This is the bare minimum. Okay?
So if I do something like walk one bus stop further away every day, it's considered cardiovascular.
But your one bus stop is how long?
I mean, averagely, I mean, or climb the stairs, like every day I do it regularly, like
okay.
Intensity and everything is there.
But then your duration must be 10 minutes without stopping.
So it's a 5 bus stop, huh?
So, yeah, so I mean, so if you want to be use those examples, then it has to be continuously without stopping 10 minutes. Yeah, so I mean, for some people, maybe walk a bit further away to buy lunch than you know.
Yeah,
yeah, you know? So try to walk up the 10 minutes. Yeah.
Yeah,
so things like that, yeah. And of course, nowadays, a lot of ladies, they say, oh, by the time I come home, I don't want to exercise, you know, because it's dark outside or weather is no good. But actually, even at home, if you are watching TV and if you just hop on the spot, without stopping again for 10 minutes non-stop, that is also considered a workout. So, yeah. So that one can be easily done, yeah. Because I know for a lot of ladies, they often say, I'm scared to go out at night, or I need to, or too tired to go out, you know. So these are the things that you can do then. But last but not the least, you must do stretching though. So it's important that you need to stretch out your body, that is in the warm-up and the cool-down phase before your actual workout. So of course the health promotion board also says what we just listed there is just a general guide. Okay, it may not be suitable for everyone. So again, you must know your body condition. So what we talk about today is just a general information. So later on in the next month, we'll have an individual session so we can actually look into case by case, okay, what sort of body, exercise is actually more suitable for you. Now let's look at how to progress your own exercise. Okay, remember we talked about the frequency, the intensity, and the duration. It's a common mistake that people often try to increase what they're doing in a short period of time too quickly. Okay, it's actually more important that you increase by the frequency first. So if you're looking at, say, walking to the bus stop for 10 minutes, 3 times a week that you're doing, then if you want to make it more, then you can consider doing it 5 times a week then or 7 times a day. So only until you've done 7 times a week already, then you increase the duration. That means instead of 10 minutes walk, then increase to 15 minutes walk, and so on. Now of course, eventually after you reach about 16 minutes of workout every time, okay, unless you enjoy it so much that you want to continue to make it more, okay, I'm sure most people by 16 minutes they feel bored already, so they cannot go on anymore. Okay, then you will start to consider maybe changing the intensity. So you never increase these 3 aspects in one time, in one period of time, yeah. So it's always followed by frequency, the duration, and the intensity. Okay. So any questions about what we just talked about? No, huh? Okay, so let's just look at what is a normal response to exercise very quickly. So of course, we know that when we exercise, our breathing rate will increase, our heart rate will increase, our blood pressure actually also increase. Okay, so actually if you measure yourself, as I was saying, your heart rate actually should, within 2 minutes after you stop exercise, should return back to normal. That's a normal response. Okay, if it takes longer than that, actually that indicates your heart is probably not working very well, or what you're doing is probably too vigorous. Okay, now, other body reaction to exercise, of course, feeling of the body heat and blood circulation. And of course, muscle aches is also very common. Okay, I often get the ladies tell me, you know, I exercise one time, I'm so sore for the next 1 week. You know? So, I mean, yes, I understand that. Okay, muscle aches is very common, but actually one way to alleviate that is to do stretching after you've done the exercise. Okay, now let's talk about the safety tips when you're exercising. Okay, it's of course very important to wear appropriate shoes, appropriate clothing. And of course, if you have to take any medication, you must make sure you take your medications before you exercise and drink plenty of water. Okay, avoid doing the contact sports. Okay, I know some people like to do a more competitive type of exercises. Actually, to start off with, we don't recommend that. Okay, yeah. And of course, when we exercise, it's important that we don't start off immediately doing vigorous type. Important to reduce the risk of falls and fractures. Okay. Now, last but not the least, of course, we must know how to monitor ourselves and also watch out for any signs and symptoms to stop. Okay? So if you notice that you're feeling unwell when you are exercising, or you feel your body is very, very achy, and you feel very short of breath, or even feeling very nauseous, you should stop exercise and seek medical attention. Okay? And of course, other things also, giddiness, chest tightness, palpitation, breathing difficulty, or even some swelling that develop immediately after exercise, whether it's in the face or the legs, or the numbness in the legs, and again nausea, again we need to stop exercising. Okay. Any questions about all these signs and symptoms? No? Okay, the last part, how to plan to start with your exercise regime. Now, for a start, okay, let's aim something achievable. So for example, I'm hearing for you are working. So maybe for you, you can consider doing maybe just a little bit of exercise, maybe during your lunchtime hours, then of course after work. So that's that's probably something to start over, yeah? Because we must also be realistic as well, yeah? So very good, you're doing that, very good, okay? And then, of course, plan some time to do exercise, but I know for a lot of mothers here, they say, I really don't have the time to exercise. But actually, you'll be surprised that, okay, for example, I think lunchtime, walking down to buy lunch, maybe you can choose a location a bit further away, is always a good start, because I'm sure no one will forget to eat their meal. So yeah, you just use that as an opportunity to maybe do a squeezing a bit of exercise. Then that will also be a good time to start to do it. And then exercise with friends and family. Of course, it's very good to have, if you have some sort of support, someone that who can do the exercise together with you, it actually has been proven that actually that shows better adherence to the exercise regime. But like I said, if you don't have a friend, never mind. At home, watching TV also can do, okay? Now, so make a part of your daily routines is probably a good tip. And then, but if you are already exercising but you are not exercising very regularly, then you try to make a consistent effort to exercise more regularly. So I'm hearing maybe you do once to twice a week. So probably that is not considered frequently enough. So maybe you want to do maybe try to squeeze some other time to do that, so make it more consistent. But if you're already exercising very regularly and you say I'm very good now, then of course just in case you feel bored, then of course you can try a variation to exercise. So instead of running, jogging, you may quite consider maybe line dancing. I mean, dancing is a good sport and good exercise to do, and it's quite enjoyable. So that could be also an option. Okay, so this is just what we suggest. If you want to or you wish to start off some sort of exercise regime, it's important that you consult your doctor first. All of you will have seen our cardiologist. So then followed by a physiotherapy assessment, then we can set goals together and then we can start your exercise. Now, of course, like I said, to start off with an exercise regime, it's always best to start off slow with light intensity first, okay? And in order to maintain an exercise regime, it's good to try a variation. So if you feel like, oh, walking on a train is very boring, then of course you can try shopping instead. Yeah, so things like that. And set goals and have some sort of family support. If you can, maybe your daughter or your children can exercise together with you, then that would be good. And also keep an exercise logbook. Okay, here actually I have an exercise sheet for you to keep a record about how much exercise you are doing. So actually I might just hand it up. So, I mean, I know all of you haven't actually had the individual sessions with me yet. But I think it's good probably for you to keep track of how much you're doing already. And you can actually write down what you've done for the day. And also, if you say one day I didn't do what I wish to do, maybe you can also write down why, the reason why you're not doing what you're supposed to do. Oh, sorry. So of course this is just a start. So for the next time when you come and see me, you can bring it over and we can discuss that. So we can know actually what actually works for you and what are the barriers that's keeping you from exercising. Oh, is it? You already know. Okay. She said that
she don't exercise, so I'm missing one exercise, but I love exercise actually.
Okay. So I hear you have palpitation, is it?
Yeah. Okay. So even when I do line dancing, I tried to go through that way by going for exercise. And within half an hour I was very bad. You know, I was swimming on here and giddy. So I thought that would stop in case I die on the dance floor kind of thing. Yeah.
Now of course in that sense probably line dancing is a bit too vigorous for you. So
yeah, but that's the lightest I can think of, and I now
but how about just walking in general?
Walking I can, but because you see I analyze it and learn that I cannot do continuous. I can dance and like say do one dance and sit down and rest.
How about the beginners?
Yeah, but it's not the intensity the time you spend.
So you're talking about the duration about
the duration.
So how long you're looking at?
It depends, because I so if it comes, I can't do anything. So if let's say it doesn't come for 2 hours, I can dance and walk for 2 hours. But if it comes in 10 minutes, I gotta stop. So that's irritating because you know because sometimes you're just gonna like build up a sweat, you know. And then you give up. Stop really. So I'm trying to find a way. I'm actually looking all around for stretch class because I know stretch is not that bad.
Yeah, stretching is another option.
Good, but nobody offers stretch now. The only class I found charged 125 for one class, one session.
Okay, you don't need that. I can show you some stretching.
Okay,
yeah.
So I was trying to like be naughty and selfish and push NUH to start for patients, inpatient who want to come and sign up. Pay a bit, you know, so that you all won't do it.
Okay, did you see my colleague? But you didn't have any intervention. Yeah, you don't have any interventions done.
I have a stand in.
Okay,
yeah, so
but the stand was done here?
Yeah, stand done here.
Do you see a video when you were...
No.
Okay.
Don't think so. I saw a lot of people, I don't know who they are.
Okay, never mind, that's okay. Because, I mean, as what you said, it sounds to me you probably prefer a more rigorous type of workout to try to break out a sweat.
I need to do it.
Yeah, because, I mean, I can easily tell you, if you just do gentle walking for 10-15 minutes, you probably will be okay.
Yeah.
And if you can do that maybe twice a day, that will also consider as a form of workout.
Yeah.
But maybe for you wish to do slightly more intense.
But having said that, my own energy level and the ability to lift has also gone down. So I mean just going marketing or shopping, and I carry stuff, heavy stuff, I get relaxed. So I'm not sure whether I enjoy myself. I got a completely black patch the other day here because I bumped against the wall. So I'm not sure I'm causing, because I'm on black fitness.
You're also on black fitness.
Yeah, yeah, so kind of irritating stuff lah. So yeah.
Body.
The trolley games. Okay, but yeah, so I'm just looking for stretch class and
okay.
I hope maybe you all can register and say like maybe NUS has some kind of class for pathetic people like me. You know, because then we can come and do it safely.
Sure.
With professional guidance, who knows what's happening. Not go to some class and like, come on, push yourself, you know, and then you're boom, you go here, down, you're down already. Yeah. That's,
okay.
Yeah. These are the commercial classes, they are more for other, they're not medical.
Yeah. I think, I mean, we do have formal classes, but more for those people who have bypass. But for stents, probably, But anyway, as well as you're saying, stretching is probably a good start for you, because I think stretching is usually quite safe. But of course, you need to know what type of stretching to do. So anyway, I will be teaching you that.
Thank you.
Okay, so, a suitable exercise has many benefits. So it's important that we need to consider the principles as the guide. Okay, the frequency, the intensity, the duration. Okay, and then before we change into a more vigorous type of workout, it's probably best to check with physios or doctors first, okay, because just in case you push yourself too hard, okay. But like I said, to start with, to do gentle workouts, you do be quite safe. Okay, so it's important to remember it's never too late to exercise, okay. So I'm sure all of you want to start off and be fitter, so that's why you're here today to listen to the talk. So is there, does anyone have any other questions for me?
Would you consider doing household chores and exercise?
Yeah, I often get asked about that. Yeah, because actually,
it is.
Like I said, I mean, anything, any activities that you do is a workout by itself. But the thing is, if you want to make it as a form of exercise, then you need to do it continuously without stopping for the minimum duration of 10 minutes at a time. So if you say I mop, then I must keep on more without stopping for 10 minutes, then that is a workout then. Yeah. So it's about whether you keep it to that duration of 10 minutes. Any other questions? No? Okay, that's good. So I hope to see you all in my individual sessions for the one-to-one consult. Now I will hand it over to our dietitian, who will then now go on to our last talk for the day.
Of all these cardiovascular diseases is because
we actually have a higher percentage of body fat compared to our Caucasian counterparts. So that's why for us,
not so good.
Yeah. Yeah, and unfortunately, when we put on weight, our weight likes to go.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but whereas Caucasian women, when they put on weight, it tends to go everywhere else except here. Mm. For us, it's here, unfortunately. Okay, so this one we cannot change. Okay, so then, okay, what is it exactly? Does it mean, okay, you need to limit your cholesterol foods? Okay, in fact, where do you actually find cholesterol in our body, in our diet? Okay, so body cholesterol, okay, 80% of cholesterol actually comes from your own body. So your liver actually makes its own cholesterol. Okay, so that is the 80% in your body now. Okay, 20% of it would come from your diet. So anything that you ingest through your mouth, okay, that is high in cholesterol, that is your 20%. Okay, so both add up together, then give you the 100%. So you can see, it doesn't mean that I X all the high cholesterol foods from my diet, means that I don't have high cholesterol. If let's say you have X all these foods, but you're still taking a lot of what we call high fat foods, okay, your body will still produce a lot of excess cholesterol as well. Okay, so excess cholesterol will then result in the cholesterol particles actually building up in your artery walls, okay, and then slowly it starts to harden and it starts to form plaque and then it forms a blockage. Okay, so in this case, after that, okay, if the blockage is really very, very bad, you would then need to go for either one stent, or in some cases, some people have needed to go for bypass surgery as well. Okay, so those are the only ways to actually get rid of the plaque or make sure that your arteries are clear again. Okay, so nothing you can now actually limit out the ring. Okay, but so then why are we listening to this diet talk? Because what we want to do today is to teach you how to prevent this blockage, if you have any, from getting any worse as well. Okay, so the targets that we normally aim for, okay, total cholesterol here, less than 5.2, LDL cholesterol less than 2.6, HDL more than 1.0, and triglycerides less than 1.7. Okay, looking at this, this is a typical cholesterol profile. Anybody can tell me if any of these cholesterols here are bad or good? Which one?
HDL is good.
HDL is good, huh? Really? Is everybody on the same page? Anyone has any other ideas? No? Okay. Yeah. So HDL, okay, the third one here, it is the only good cholesterol in your body. Okay, this one over at the bottom, the triglycerides, okay, this is not actually a type of cholesterol. This is actually a type of fat that is stored in your body. Okay, so for example, if you are somebody who likes to entertain a lot, you like to go for high tea, you like to have your desserts, you like to have your alcohol, you like to have your deep fried food, and you like to have them excessively. Okay, and you consume so much, but you don't really like to exercise. Then how? You don't utilize all this extra energy, your body then creates more fat, okay, or more triglycerides. So this is the storage of fat inside your body. In some cases where you have very, very high triglyceride levels, okay, you are actually putting yourself at risk of a second, third, fourth, fifth heart attack. Okay? Yeah. So usually the higher your triglycerides, usually the higher the amount of fat inside your body and the higher your risk of a recurrent heart attack. Okay. So just a summary. So bad fats is the in your blood, LDL, the triglycerides. So these are the ones we want them to be low. And the only good fat would be the HDL, which we want to be high in our body. Okay? So like I mentioned, looking at what the diagram said just now, it doesn't mean that we avoid all the cholesterol-containing foods and it's safe. Okay, we still need to look at other types of food. Okay, so dietary cholesterol, of course, this is a major part. It's still 20%. So where is it mostly found in? It's mostly found in all your animal products. So things like your organ meats, okay, seafoods, egg yolks, okay, quite what we call fish roll, prawn roll, those kind of things. So if you like Japanese food a lot, the ikura, ebiko, all the other things, all the go, okay, yeah. So all very high cholesterol. Okay, so just as a rough guideline, usually for people with cholesterol issues, okay, we are recommending for you not to have more than 200 milligrams of cholesterol in a day. Okay, so that is daily dietary intake. Okay, you don't need to feel very sad because even normal healthy people, the recommendation is no more than 300 milligrams of cholesterol in your diet on a daily basis. So 100 milligrams, not really that much. So let's just take a look at some food items just so you have a rough idea what we're actually talking about. Okay, so if you take one portion of your internal organs like brain, for example, okay, so one portion is only 90 grams. Outside portion is usually double, triple this, okay? So one portion would be about 850 milligrams of cholesterol per serving. Okay, then we look at something that's very common in our Singaporean diet, egg. Okay, so one whole egg would be about 240 milligrams of cholesterol. Okay, whole egg meaning if you eat the egg yolk. If you're only eating the egg white, 0 milligrams of cholesterol. Okay, so then...
So is it braised egg or any kind of egg?
Any kind of egg in general. This is just an example. Yeah, as long as you're eating the whole egg with the yolk included.
Yes, yeah. Then it's okay to eat only the whites.
Yes, it is okay to eat only the
yolk.
The
yolk is nice, but okay.
Yes, no. Yeah, half.
Why I don't like the yolk.
Yes. Oh, like the hard boiled egg. Oh, yeah. Some people don't like it because they say very powdery.
Yeah, yeah.
But this one is individual preference. Yeah. So other things also like the seafood, so things like your oysters, okay, cockles, things with sea han, all that, okay, around 200-300 plus milligrams of cholesterol as well. Okay, then we look at other things, so things like your bird, chicken, liver, other kinds of seafood like your shellfish, prawns, crabs, okay, all around 150-100 odd milligrams of cholesterol per serving. But like I said, this per serving down here is not the serving that we are used to outside. This one is only a 90 gram portion. 90 gram portion is probably only about 1/3 or 1/4 of what you would normally eat outside. Okay, if you're going for those large seafood dinners especially. Okay? So just so you have a rough idea.
But how is that the ikan kampung, huh?
Yes.
Has got about 90 grams.
60.
Something like
The one that the usually nasi padang store they like to sell something like that la. Yeah. So because it's stuffed with sambal. Sambal is normally made with your dried prawns, all those kind of things. So
without
sugar. Yeah. No. So but the thing is animal products. So the fish itself does have cholesterol as well.
Yes, it's good.
But it's an animal. It's an animal, right?
I thought they were saying only the pomfret, which is very hard.
We will address that in a while. Okay. So fish generally, because it's also an animal, it does have cholesterol as well. But of course, because it is not really in my list here, you can see the difference now, okay? So you can see this ikan kembung, even when the sambal is only 60 milligrams, compared to, let's say you have 5 prawns. Okay, comparatively, it is a big difference as well, okay? So it's only a small amount of cholesterol compared to the other high cholesterol foods. Okay, so knowing your dietary fat, so the one thing that we would want you to do, okay, is to have an idea what are the different types of fats in your body. Okay, of course there are certain things that we do tell you to limit, so things that are high in saturated fat and trans fat, okay, we would then want you to replace them with the monounsaturated fat or the polyunsaturated fats. Okay, okay, so saturated fats, okay, saturated fats will come from things like your chicken skin, lard, okay, fats from your meat, full cream dairy products, okay, butter, coconut milk, okay, palm oil or vegetable oil. And there's one very special thing over here as well. Coffee mate. Anybody know why?
Coffee mate.
full of saturated fat, but what is coffee made actually made out of?
Milk and sugar.
Milk and sugar? No. It's a non-dairy creamer.
Non-dairy?
Non-dairy, it means no milk products inside.
Yes. Animal fat.
Yes.
Yes.
What animal fats?
What fat?
What fat is it? Palm oil. Yes. Don't believe me, later on when you're on your way home, if you pass by a supermarket, you can pick up the packet of Coffee Mate and see within the first few ingredients, the first thing you will see, palm olive oil. Same as your vegetable oil or palm oil. Same thing.
So that means the 3-in-1s all have palm oil.
Yes. So because they will all have Coffee Mate, so then they will be having amount of palm oil as well, correct? So for things like coffee milk, okay, coconut milk, all this kind of thing, of course we're telling you to cut all this down. Okay, it doesn't mean that you don't take your 3-in-1 coffee. Okay, of course we also look at the amount that you are taking, which is why you know it's very important when you come up for follow-up sessions, okay, we will go through quite a detailed diet history with you as well. Okay, so we will actually target certain things in your diet. Okay, for you to make sure you cut down on. Yeah. Okay? So, yeah.
This one you want to
try? So we want you to then replace it with what we call the MUFAs or monounsaturated fats. So this would be things like okay, your olive oil, okay, peanut oil, 100% peanut oil, canola oil, rice bran oil, avocado, nuts, this kind of things. Okay, when we tell you to replace these in your diet, means that for example, if you are using a vegetable oil to do cooking at home, then choose something like that instead. Okay. For monounsaturated fats, this one is quite targeted. This one helps to bring down your bad cholesterol levels or your LDL cholesterol levels. Okay? So these are things that you can choose to use for cooking at home. Or you can also replace with what we call the polyunsaturated fats, which will be things like your corn oil, soya bean oil, grapeseed oil, sesame oil, sunflower oil, and other kind of things. Okay. So for this one, this would actually target both your total and bad cholesterol levels. So if you are somebody who has very, very low good cholesterol levels, means your HDL is nowhere near the one range, okay? Then don't choose this one. Because when your total cholesterol come down, okay, your good cholesterol also very hard to bring up. So then you would choose this one instead. The monounsaturated fat. So you just bring down your bad cholesterol level. Okay? So things like avocado, nuts, all that, you can have them as part of your healthy diet. Okay? All sorts of nuts. Of course, what kind of nuts? Kacang putih, those kind. Okay, those deep fried, coated with sugar, all that. Of course not. Okay? We are talking about raw, dry roasted, those kind. Lightly salted, preferably no salt, but okay. You ownself do at home, that would be okay. Okay? Usually for nuts, a good guideline would be a small woman's handful. So if you are looking at amount wise, normally it's about 12 to 15 almonds, okay, or 10 to 12 pieces of walnuts, or even like you know, cashews would be about 15 pieces, something like that. So that's why I said small woman's handful, not one big bowl. Okay? There are some people who say, oh, nuts very good. End up, right, they take so much nuts in their diet. They come back and see Dr. Lam say, hey, how come your triglycerides so high? Refer back to dietitian. What happened with the diet? So although these are healthy types of fats, okay, you do need to look at the amount that you are eating as well. Okay?
Mm-hmm. of this all, I mean, about the people and the
goodness? Okay, so of course, it depends. Most of the time, we look at what we're actually using them for. Chinese cooking, usually olive oil, not so super.
Yeah, because it's not supposed to be. Yeah.
Yes, so, and usually the smoking point is not very high. So, it depends on what kind of food you're actually cooking at home. Things like canola oil, all that is okay, rice bran oil, peanut oil, they're all fine as well. It all boils down mainly to preference. Yeah. So, but these are the ones that are higher in monounsaturated fats. Okay? Yeah. Okay, then we also look at omega 3 fats. This one comes as part of the polyunsaturated fat group. Okay, so of course we look at things like tuna, salmon, mackerel, trout, okay, sardines, cod fish, okay. So tuna, even canned tuna is allowed as well. Okay, of course, okay, not brine, soak in water, okay. Okay, soak in brine means a lot of extra salt inside as well. Okay, so usually we recommend you to take the one in water, and then we tell you to use your own method of cooking to flavor the tuna. For example, some people find that, you know, just putting a bit of lime, put a bit of like those corn niblets is actually quite nice, and children normally like to eat that as well. Okay, or some people say, I don't know, I like curry tuna. Okay, you can lightly fry it with a bit of, you know, curry spice powder, rempah that you have. Okay, that's also fine as well. Okay, of course not if you're adding coconut milk to it. So all the other flavoured ones, like the coconut milk, the mayonnaise, all these tend to be quite high in fat because they're all extra sources of oil. Okay? And yeah, so usually for omega-3 fatty acids, as you can see over here, they mostly come from your deep sea oily fish. So these ones we normally recommend you to have in your diet at least an average of 2 to 3 times in a week for you to get the benefits from omega-3. Omega-3's proven health benefit is with preventing the formation of the plaque, okay, and helping to protect your blood vessels for good health. Yeah. So normally 2 to 3 times a week is fine as well. Okay. If you are somebody who don't like the taste of fish, okay, take fish oil capsule also okay. Okay. So but this one normally we try and tell you to go based on your diet first. Okay, and then one other thing that we wanted you to limit in your diet would be this thing called trans fat. So trans fat will be referring mainly to all your processed food items. Okay, so this one, especially if you know you like to go supermarket, right, you will see a lot of products like to claim trans fat free. Why do they like to put this claim? Because in the United States, right, there was this big recently about limiting the amount of trans fat in the food because they found that the more trans fat there is in the food, they actually worse health prognosis people actually have. Okay, so trans fat is mainly present in all your processed foods because of the way they use to actually bake and preserve the oil in the foods. Basically, they want the food to actually stay fresher, stay crispy for a longer period of time. They use a particular type of oil or a particular type of cooking process. Okay, so mainly in our diet will come from all your fried foods, pastries, baked goods, and also your hard margarine. So hard margarine referring to things like your plantain, daisy, those kind of things, vegetable shortenings. Okay, so just now I say cannot eat butter.
Yeah.
Now I say cannot eat margarine. How? Make kosong.
Soya bread. But butter now, everybody else start buying butter. Don't eat margarine, no good for you. Everybody else is telling me.
Yeah, why?
At one time, say, margarine good to eat butter.
Yeah. So, what do we actually choose? Let's take a look down. So that's why you're here to learn. Okay, so we actually take a look at this comparison. Okay, this is basically looking at the amount of fat per serving, which is in 1 tablespoon. Okay, so looking at butter, margarine, okay, both types of margarine. Okay, so just now I said got hard margarine, there's also a version called soft margarine. Okay, so these two are different. Okay, if we look at the total fat per tablespoon, they are roughly the same, around 10 to 11 grams. So, not real surprise there because they're all fats. Okay, Then we look at the amount of saturated fat, which was the first bad fat we talked about, that are in these products. Okay, so per serving for butter, there's about 7.2 grams of saturated fat. Okay, whereas if you compare the hard and the soft margarine, eh, only about 1 to 2 grams, eh, much lower than the butter. Correct? So then in this case, you can say, margarine seems to be the better choice already. Okay, then we look at the other fat that we talked about, the trans fat. Okay, the one that actually is not very good for your heart. Okay, so trans fat is actually very high in the hard margarines because of the process of hydrogenation. Okay, so in total, if we look at the combined amount of all these bad fats, butter still has the most. Margarine, hard margarine, still quite high also. Then we have soft margarine. So this would be the choice that you make at home. So soft margarine will be things that you find in the fridge compartment of the supermarket. So things like Neosoft, olive grove, okay, even NTUC brand, canola olive also can. Okay? So these are the kinds that you would find in the supermarket. Okay, and as you can see down here, butter also got cholesterol. Because butter is the only thing down here that comes from animal products. Okay? So, just a short recap. So, does it mean that you can include a large amount of good fats in your diet? Just now I kind of answered that question indeed. So, anyone still going to say, yes, I can include a lot? So, yeah, you should not, because they are actually all the same in calories. Okay, so good fat, bad fat, okay, each gram, as you saw just now, all roughly about the same. Per tablespoon, all about 10 to 11 grams of fat. Okay, then, okay, if you take all this extra fat, okay, it's more calories, you end up getting more overweight, or you end up, even from going for overweight, you're obese. Okay, and so main thing is you need to limit your fried oily foods to about twice a week at most. Okay, so then also we look at fiber in your diet, okay? So fiber in your diet usually would come from sources like your fruit and vegetables, okay? Beans and lentils, okay? Whole grain products like your brown rice, whole grain bread, cereals, and even oats, okay? So all these are sources of fiber in your diet. Fiber is very important for people with heart problems, with general cardiovascular problems, so things like hypertension as well, okay, if you have diabetes as well, fiber is a good thing for you to be having in your diet. One, because it helps to bring down your cholesterol, helps to control your blood pressure, it helps to also bring down your sugar levels, and the main thing is fiber keeps you full. When you are full, you are less likely to go around and hunt for things to put in your mouth. Okay, so normally we do recommend you to have a bit more fiber in your diet. Okay, so when we say more fiber, okay, if you actually look at guidelines in Singapore, okay, we only ask you to have 2 servings of fruit and 2 servings of veggies every day. In Australia, this is 2 servings of fruit and 5 servings of veggie. Singapore already, people, 1 serving of veggie, very hard to meet. Imagine if you are eating outside for all your meals. Okay? You buy fishball noodle. If you are lucky, you got 1 piece of lettuce inside. If you're not lucky, nothing inside. Okay? Then you buy wonton mee, 2 strands. See? 1 lettuce plus 2 strands, not even 1 serving. Okay? So 1 serving is generally about, if you are looking at a dinner plate, it's about 1/4 of a dinner plate of cooked vegetables. Okay? If you are looking at cup, okay, it's about 2/3 to 3/4 of a cup of cooked vegetables. Okay? And we also look at whole grains. Okay? So whole grains will be your brown rice, all that. Especially this one down here, oats. Okay? Oats has had a proven benefit with helping people with heart diseases to actually bring down your cholesterol quite significantly. So even if you're taking it, you know, twice a week, all that, it does actually help you with bringing down your cholesterol. Okay, so because of the amount of fiber and soluble fiber inside. Okay.
So of course salt intake, you do need to talk about this as well. Okay? Because when you have heart issues, okay, likelihood that you have blood pressure issues as well is quite high. So when you have excess salt intake, it can actually cause you to have very poorly managed blood pressure. Okay, so normally what we tell you to do with regards to sauces or that, so we are eating outside, don't put sauce on your rice. Okay, or if you're ordering things like noodles, try to go for soup noodles instead of dry noodles. Okay, and of course not to drink the soup. Okay, avoid things like all your processed food, so like your ham, your bacon, those kind of things. Okay, leaving out gravy and soup, okay, like I mentioned, okay, and try alternative flavorings and using fresh food in general. Okay, so alternative flavorings, right, would be things like, okay, all your natural food flavorings, like your onions, shallots, okay, chili, five spice powder, ginger, coriander, curry spices, garlic, okay. There's a lot of natural herbs and spices out there to actually season our food, lemon grass as well. So it doesn't mean no salt, no taste. Okay? There's so many other natural things that you can add to your food as well. Okay. So alcohol. Okay. So the main guideline for alcohol is, if you are not someone that is drinking already, there is no actual need to start drinking alcohol. Okay. If you do drink alcohol, okay, you need to have alcohol 3 days in a week. Okay, so usually this would be something like alternate days should be alcohol free. Okay, so alternate day, that means at least 3 to 4 days in a week should be alcohol free. And each day that you actually do drink something, okay, you should not be having anything more than 1 unit of alcohol. So 1 unit of alcohol is actually not very much. Okay, if you are looking at wine, okay, it's about a small glass, about 100 mils. Okay, so if normally, let's say you go outside restaurant, when they pour that glass for you, it is easily 150 to 200 mils. Okay, so not that kind of glass, small glasses only. Okay, if it's like spirits, so your hard liquor, all that, about 30 mils is about 1 unit of alcohol. Okay, but the main thing is with alcohol, why we tell you not to start. When you take a lot of excess alcohol all of a sudden, for example, from someone who doesn't drink at all, you decide that, hey, I heard red wine is very good for my heart. Today, from today onwards, every day I drink 1/3 of a bottle, half a bottle. After a while, you find that, hey, how come my weight keep going up also? Because it's a lot of extra calories which are not needed in your diet. Okay, and also when you have a lot of extra calories, remember what part of your cholesterol goes up? Your triglyceride levels. Okay, so this one actually causes your triglyceride levels to go up quite high as well. So alcohol, no, if you're not drinking already. Okay, so mainly with cooking at home, try to use oil sparingly, removing all fats and skin from your meats, choosing leaner cuts of meats. Okay. Choosing low-fat milk instead of coconut milk, or even low-fat milk instead of full cream milk when you're doing beverages at home. Okay. The other thing is also limit your deep frying to a maximum of twice in 1 week. Okay. So, grocery shopping. The main thing is of course looking out for this healthier choice symbol. Okay. But nowadays, this healthier choice symbol, so many things out there. No salt, no sugar, lower saturated fat, trans fat free, all these things. Especially now, also one that like to say cholesterol free. Okay? So cholesterol free, just to clarify first, doesn't mean that you can pick more of that food. Why? Because cholesterol free, normally where do you see it? Especially when you're buying oil. Okay, remember just now I mentioned about the vegetable oil. You can be buying vegetable oil and you can still see this symbol on there. Why? Because it will say cholesterol free. Of course cholesterol free, no animal product inside, right? So again, you need to look at what kind of food product you are buying and what is the suitable thing to actually look at for this product. Okay, so for example, for oil, you over in saturated fat instead of low cholesterol. Okay, if let's say for example you are buying bread, so looking for something that's higher in whole grains, higher in fiber, something like that. Okay, so with all these higher, lower, all this kind of thing. Okay, as a general guideline, they are only 25% higher or 25% lower compared to the reference product. So it's not a very big jump. Okay, but if you are buying within that group, it is a healthier choice within that group. So you cannot say that I buy this milk because it says lower in fat. I don't want to buy this bread because it's got no symbol. Okay, you must compare within the same product category. So this one we will probably go through a bit more in the next session, okay, to talk about how you actually choose healthier foods and all that outside. Okay, so the main thing to remember, it is a long-term commitment. Okay, it is not something you can change overnight and then, wow, that's it. No. It's not a one-time thing as well, it is something that you do need to follow lifelong. Okay? So as you can see, we don't just focus on any one particular type of food. So I didn't tell you don't eat eggs, right? Okay? You can still eat your eggs, but maybe what you can do in this case is limit your consumption of the egg yolk to maximum about 2 or 3 in a week. Okay? Yeah. So you still need variety. Not just telling you to only eat oats, okay? You eat oats every day, I also cannot eat oats every day, okay? So, have variety in your diet, okay? Any questions from anybody? Yes?
Now you see at the supermarkets, some eggs are just today. Low cholesterol. Something like that. How do you know what is the thing about this egg?
Okay. Omega 3, all that is because they are giving the chicken a special type of feed to get the omega 3 inside. Okay. But with eggs, right? Okay, all these beta carotene, omega 3, not really so much of a concern for us. We are more concerned on the cholesterol inside the egg yolk itself. So for those that say lower in cholesterol, remember I said lower means 25% less than reference. So you take 200 times 75, okay, we said 240, right? Average is 240. Times 75 is still about 180 milligrams of cholesterol inside. So still to the higher end of your allowable amount of cholesterol. Yeah, so even if you are choosing the low cholesterol egg, you still need to limit your intake to about 2 or 3 in a week maximum of the yolk. Yeah, if you want to take more of the white, it's okay.
Yes, you talk about omega 3, right? That can lower the cholesterol.
It's more of lowering your triglycerides and your cholesterol.
What about omega 6?
Omega 6, okay.
What's the difference?
Okay, omega 6 and omega 3 is basically where the double bond is. It's a chemical difference. Okay, omega 3, it is more well studied compared to omega 6. Okay, omega 6 is not as well studied at the moment. And usually for omega 3, because we are looking at your deep sea oily fishes, so this is the one that most people have been targeting, your EPA, DHA. With omega 6, it's not that there is no health benefits. It's not that, it's just that it's not very proven yet. So if you are choosing, like I know some of the oils now, they like to put high in omega 6 and omega 9 or omega 3, omega 6. Okay, as long as you make sure that kind of oil that you are choosing is a healthier type of oil, it's still.
You mentioned things like seeds being good for our diet. What about nuts?
They are also fine as well. I mean,
you know, there's so many things in the organic shops, like flax, chia, all those.
Okay, so all these, yes. Okay, all these seeds are generally okay. They usually have some kind of oil in them as well, because nuts and seeds generally have some type of oil inside. So these are the ones that are normally high in your omega 6. For flax seed would be omega 3. So they have your oil health. oils in them, okay? They also are quite rich in all your antioxidants, or that which are, you know, there's some evidence.
It won't harm us, it's okay.
It won't harm you to take it, but we also look at the amount that you are taking.
Okay. This, it's very expensive for money.
Yes, it is.
I'm not sure whether the value, physical value versus the monetary value.
Well, generally we do tell you to, based on what your current diet is, to just make modifications there. We do not really recommend or advocate for going to change your diet completely, like, oh, Mediterranean diet is good, I change to Mediterranean diet. It's not something that we are used to, so we don't advocate things like that. Yeah. For example, realize why I didn't talk about HDL at all. Mm-hmm. I mean, I only talk about bringing it down. I haven't talked about anything to eat and bring it up, because there's nothing you can eat that will bring up this HDL. The only thing you can do to bring up your HDL or good cholesterol is listen to the PT Kemi and do a bit more exercise. Yeah. So you can see diet and exercise all linked. Yeah, it's not just I change my diet, I don't need to exercise, everything is fine with that. Everything is
so no organ in our body can create or manufacture
good. Your liver does create it, but it's just that it needs more exercise to achieve it.
You said that there's no food that will improve the HDL?
Yes.
There's
no proven food.
Really? Because all my best misconception that
yes, some
nuts
that,
will increase the HDL. No?
More like, I know some people say omega 3 increases your HDL, but so far, not a 100% statement there across the board. So, I mean, the only thing that we know for sure 100% that increases your HDL is exercise.
But the funny thing is, I don't exercise at all. If you do consider household chores and exercise, then I do. I have exercise every day. Other than that, I don't really go out and exercise.
So I mean,
but my HDL is high, and I want at this question: is there a limit where it's too high for its own good?
Usually, no. We look at your whole lipid profile as a whole. Of course, if everything is high together with it, then maybe it's not such a good idea that you have such a high HDL then, okay, because everything else is high together with it, okay. But if let's say your HDL is the one that's high and everything else, you know, is, you know, within the normal range, it's still fine. Yeah. Okay. Any other questions? No? With no other questions, anyway, we will be seeing, if you all have signed up for the individual follow-up, so I will be seeing you for the individual follow-up as well. So then we can always discuss a few more questions and a few more individualized things you might have about your own diet at home or something like that.